Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So let's get started. It's our pleasure to welcome Jingyi. We should say welcome back, Jingyi Li, to give a presentation on some of the research he has done at Georgetown. As everybody knows, that he spent last summer with us doing the intern work, and the work has been really well done. So by the time we invite him back to give a lecture, we thought that maybe he should talk about something beyond, much more beyond what he has done, you know, that everybody knows here. So what he decided to do is to present some of the machine learning work that he has been doing, which is called the soft margin estimation. Most of people sitting here probably may have known that this work that he put, the preliminary piece of the work that he is going to present here, was actually awarded with the best paper award during last year's InterSpeech conference. So today we're going to hear more update about that kind of work that everybody have heard about. Okay, I'll give the floor to you.
Good morning. It's my great pleasure to come back to present my work. It optimizes the HM parameters with the idea of margin in machine learning and the idea of decision feedback in discriminative training in ASR. Then I will extend the framework of SME to jointly optimize the HM parameters and acoustical parameters together. This is called soft margin feature extraction. For the ASR task, there are two most challenging tasks. One is for robust ASR, one is in the LVCSR. I will introduce how SME can perform well in both tasks. Finally, the conclusion and the future work will be given. In machine learning, we want to minimize some expected risk. For different kind of learning problems, we have different loss functions. For example, for pattern recognition, we use the 0, 1 loss function. For regression, we use the mean square. Especially for ASR task, if we want to use maximum likelihood estimation, we use the minimum log likelihood as the loss function. If we want to use these three most popular discriminative training methods, we have the corresponding loss functions in this table. Our target is to minimize some expected risk or test risk. However, we do not exactly know what's the distribution of our testing data. Therefore, there is a popular method to minimize the expected risk on the basis of training data. If we have n training samples, we just want to minimize the empiric risk on these n training samples. If n is very large, the training data can stand for the testing data very well. Everything is fine. However, if the number of n is not very large, what's the difference between the empiric risk and the test risk? There is a famous inequality from the statistical learning theory. The test risk is bounded by summation of two parts. The first one is the empiric risk, which is the risk on the training set. The second one is the generalization term, is a function of VC dimension. This bound, in fact, is not very tight. However, it can give us some idea how to design a good classifier. Currently, most large-scale LVCR systems use more than thousands of our training data. They get success. Why? Because they have large N and the empirical risk doesn't change a lot. However, the generalization term will decrease because of we increasing N. If we keep increasing N, finally the generalization term will approach to zero and the test risk will approach to empirical risk. That's the reason why large amount of training data can help. How about more parameters? If we have more parameters, we can fit the data very well. So we reduce the empirical risk. However, we have to increase the VC dimension because for fixed type of classifier, if we have more parameters, usually we have larger VC dimension. Therefore, the empirical risk drops. The generalization term increases. After some point, if you keep increasing the model parameters, there will be a problem of overfitting. Currently, most discriminative training methods, they want to reduce the empirical risk based on different kind of loss functions. In contrast, the margin-based method wants to reduce the generalization term by reducing VC dimension. Because VC dimension is bounded by decreasing function of margin, therefore margin-based method wants to increase margin. The most famous large margin-based method is support vector machine. However, SVM cannot be directly applied to ASR task because ASR task is a sequential classification problem. Also, there are large amount of classes in the ASR task. Recent years, there have been some margin-based methods proposed in ASR. The first one is large margin estimation. It marks the margin based on the correct classified samples. As we know, the misclassified samples are also very important for classified design. Therefore, they fixed this problem in ICASP 2007. The second one is called large margin HM. It minimizes the summation of Gaussian model traces penalized with misclassification measure. This one is very good because it comes directly from the idea of support vector machine. However, it makes some approximation to ensure the final objective function is convex. Sometimes this approximation hurts this method. As they have reported, if they do not know the exact phoneme boundary in advance, they cannot get a performance improvement. They suspect this is because of the approximation. The third one is large margin MCE proposed in MSR. This is an extension of MCE. It views the offset in the sigmoid function as a margin. The last one is soft margin estimation proposed by us. This method maximizes the margin with a penalized misclassification measure. For SME, we have two target functions. One is to maximize the margin. If we can maximize the margin, the samples are pushed away from the decision boundary. However, if we have very large margin, there are a lot of samples may fall inside this margin. and we believe those samples are possible misclassified samples. SME wants to balance the margin maximization and the loss minimization of possible misclassified samples. This is the objective function of SME. With this small lambda, we combine the margin maximization and the loss minimization together. For any utterance OI, we have a separation measure DOI, big lambda. If this separation measure is less than the value of margin, we believe there is a loss. Therefore, we use this kind of hinge loss function to build the final target function. The question is, how can we define this separation measure? The most popular one is the utterance-based log likelihood ratio. We have a target string and SI, and we have a competing string, SI hat. We use.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
Can you go back one slide?
Mm-hmm.
By using the hinge loss function, it seems like that would weight things that are poorly labeled in the training data too high. Do you find that to be a problem at all?
In fact, I believe that because hinge loss function is this one, and if you take a derivative of this hinge loss function, every sample contribute equally to your final one. And as I will state later, this hinge loss function is proposed by us, not proposed by us, it's directly from supported machine. And we originally use this one, but this one is not immune to outliers. In fact, I will show you later, SME has a flexible objective function. We use hinge loss function here, but it doesn't mean always SME needs to use hinge loss function. Sometimes we need to deal with the outlier, and I will give you some example later.
Okay. So you may be aware of this work by Fei Xia and Larry Saul.
Yes.
The way they dealt with that issue is that they use the same kind of
function so that deweight, but they deweight
them down, yeah, according to the distance.
Yes.
How does that compare to some of the things that you're trying to do?
But
I think the idea should be good there. You solve both problems.
Yes.
You keep convexity, mm-hmm, at the same time, you actually minimize that kind of outline.
Okay.
Is your solution different than that?
A good question. Because I think what they have done is another kind of loss function. They deweighted the most negative samples. Another way is just to use the MCE kind of loss function, 0-1 loss function. In fact, I'm not sure, as I have stated, I'm not sure convexity is a good thing, because of course, if you have an objective function of convexity, it's very nice. The local minimum is just the global minimum. However, when they make some approximation to reach that goal, after they make that approximation, as they have stated in their thesis, if they know exactly the phoneme boundary in advance, they can do a very good thing. However, if they do not know the phoneme boundary, sometimes they cannot even get any performance improvement. Of course, I'm sure in their thesis, they suspect that's because of the approximation to make the objective function as a convex function. For this utterance-based log likelihood ratio, usually large margin estimation, or MSE, uses this kind of loss function. However, we proposed to use a normalized log likelihood ratio. We just pick out the frames that have different labels in the target and the competing strings, and sum the log likelihood ratio of these frames together, normalized by the number of different frames. Why we do this kind of thing? because we want to take into consideration of the utterance length and the number of different models in the competing strings. Give you an example. If we have two strings, two utterances, the first one is a short utterance, has about two competing model pairs. The second one is a long utterance, has about 20 competing model pairs. Usually, the log-likelihood ratio of this long utterance will give you larger log-likelihood ratio. However, this doesn't mean that the models inside this long utterance have more discriminative power than the models in the short utterance. Therefore, we make some normalization here. By combining the above formulas, we reach the final objective function of SME. In the first formula, as we have stated, this D separation measure is to measure the separation between the target and the competing string. Therefore, we have a discriminative separation here. If we expand the hinge loss function as this function, we just select the utterance that have separation measure less than the value of margin out to contribute the final target function. We believe this is utterance selection. Then we expand the separation measure in the third formula. And here, we select different labels out. This is a frame selection. In fact, SME is a flexible framework for discriminative separation, utterance selection, and frame selection. Also, we use the hinge loss function here and use different labels here for utterance and frame selection. We can use other selection policies in different kinds of applications. For example, we need to take care about the outliers. Yes, I see. Because for example, if we do not use the frame selection, for example, we just use the utterance-based log-likelihood ratio. As I have given you an example, usually the long utterance will give you large likelihood ratio. And this one will be, this separation measure will be larger than the some margin value. Therefore, we tend to not consider the long utterance if the utterance have a lot of distinct models. And in fact, here, this idea is very simple, but I will show you later. Sometimes this frame discrimination will give you some power to get an even better model. I will show you later.
So it's more like normalization.
In this one, it's a normalization, but later, I will show you the frame selection sometimes is not the normalization.
In this likelihood ratio you have, yes.
Mm-hmm.
If the labels, if the indicator function is
this
zero,
one. Yeah, zero,
then the ratio should be one, shouldn't it? Because you have the same, same labels in the numerator and the denominator. It seems like the indicator function is redundant.
Let me see.
Zero when the labels are the same.
Yes. Maybe, yes. I'm sure what you have said. You mean that if this one is equal to this one, and this is, yes. I just put this frame selection function here. In this case, it's redundant, but later, in some case, it's not redundant.
Okay.
I just want to show that SME can have some a flexible framework for both the utterance selection and the frame selection. We will have different kind of selection policies later in some other tasks. how to solve SME. It's very easy. Just use the sigmoid function to approximate the indicator function here. And then we use GPD algorithm to optimize both the HM parameters and the soft margin together. Here, I want to compare SME with three other margin-based methods. For the training samples, nearly all the methods use all the training samples. For LME, except the work in ICAT 2007, they usually use correct classified samples. Their major interest is in how to design different kind of optimization methods to solve LME. For separation measure, both LME and large margin MCE use utterance-based log likelihood ratio, and the large margin HM use Mahanonobis distance. SME uses the frame normalized log likelihood ratio. For target function, LME maximizes the margin. Large margin HM minimizes the trace with a penalized hinge loss function. MCE is just to minimize the smooth 0-1 loss function. SME maximizes the margin with a penalized hinge loss function. LME, large margin HM, SME can automatically get the margin value. For convexity, both the LME and the large margin HM can have a convex objective function. As I have said, this is a real nice property. However, they make some approximation to reach the final convex objective function, there may be some danger. For large In ICAT 2007. Yeah, I have mentioned the latter one. In ICAT 2007, they. Offset. You mean this non-linear function? Yeah, it's a non-linear. Yes, you can explain that offset is a margin. However, the final one, I believe the final one is just a 0-1, just a sigmoid function, right?
So the recent paper that we wrote on that work is that you can break up this whole term into two terms.
Yes. Yeah.
That result from the integration that goes beyond, you know, the boundary of zero. And that
yes.
Is
yeah, that can be, yes. Here, what I see is that, yes, this one integrate margin into the sigmoid function. However, if we just look at the final target function, it's just a sigmoid function, right? It's a 0-1 loss function. But this is not 0-1 loss is not directly related with the original MCE's 0-1 loss function. Yeah. But this one embedded a margin into it, right?
So another comment on this comparison on the second category, LM, HMM. I think there's one very important aspect of that work is that after they did all this approximation, the whole HMM is not going to be probabilistic anymore because the variance is interpreted as a, it's not tied into.
Yes, you're right. Yes.
So I think that may make the model more powerful because it's less constrained than everything else. Because ultimately, you're doing parallel recognition, you're not doing things in estimation. So I don't know, what's your comment on that?
I'm not sure whether.
Yeah. Allow them to get
Yes. And they made another approximation. In fact, they just use the best, in every frame, they just use the best Gaussian, not use the Gaussian mixture model. With this kind of approximation, they can make the final target function as a convex function. And there is no report from large margin estimation or large margin HM that they can be applied to LVCSR task. But LVCSR task is very important for ASR. Large margin MCE, because it's an extension of MCE, of course, it can be applied to any LVCSR task. I will show you later, SME can also do this kind of work.
So what do you say, no, yes?
This one, because their original one, their original formulation is not convex.
Since
I think Inter's speech 2006, yeah. Here, I compare the SME with three other methods. We trained the 12-state whole world model. Both MCE and SME are initiated from MLE, and LME is initiated from MCE. This work is directly got from Xinwei Li's thesis. And for 16 mixture model, we can get about 99.3% string accuracy. Even one mixture model, we can get better string accuracy than the 16 mixture MLE model. Here, SME is significantly better than MLE, better than MCE, and is comparable with LME. This is the string accuracy on the training set. After 200 iterations, we can see all the different kind of mixture models have a different kind of string accuracies in the beginning. Finally, they reach the same string accuracy, about 100% accurate. The question is, for the testing, we can see different kind of models have different testing accuracy. But in the training set, we have nearly the same string accuracy. What happens? This is the separation measure for the one mixture MLE model. After SME training, we can see most of samples are pushed right away with great separation measure. We can see there is a sharp boundary around the value of 5. We believe less margin. Also, we can see this is the 16 mixture case. We have a sharp boundary around the value of 9. The conclusion is that although we have a different kind of string accuracies in the training set, however, because of the different margin values, the 16 mixture model can have better string accuracy than the 1 mixture model. This is the histogram of the separation measure in the testing set. Because SME is the best in this case, we can see the rightmost curve is SME. The samples have larger separation measures. It's interesting to look at the one mixture case. Now, the rightmost curve is MCE. However, if we look at the left side, we can see SME, the samples adjusted from SME have less, here we have less misclassified samples. Therefore, even in one mixture case, SME outperforms MCE. What conclusion we can get? If we have a lot of model parameters, this classifier has more discriminative power. SME can adjust the model parameter, make all the samples pushed right away, have largest population measure. However, if in the one mixture case, we just have less model parameters, the model cannot have great discriminative power. SME is just focused on the samples that are possible misclassified, making SME can get less error in the testing set. In the following, I will introduce how SME can be applied to jointly optimize the acoustical features and the HM parameters together. For ASR task, usually we use the standard MFCC. The speech is transformed to the frequency domain and take the log field bank, get the output, use DCT to reduce the dimension and use optional lift to get the final MFCC. Here, the DCT matrix is fixed. We do not design this matrix from some data. However, we know that the driven method is very powerful in ASR task. How about to design this transformation matrix with some data-driven method?
Well, actually, there has been some work done on optimizing this by using MC doing this block.
Yes. Yes.
Also, I think somebody from Baum-Welch also
They optimize this lift. Yeah. They call the discriminative feature extraction.
So this has got to be large margin version.
Yeah, this is the large margin version. Yes. And in that case, they are using the MLE optimization method, not the discriminative training method, right? For example, HLDA, it uses the MLE optimization.
Also, I remember somebody called Brian Mack also did the work of pushing discriminative training back to filter bank. So I just wonder the reason why you don't do the filter. I think that was quite a positive result.
You mean to design this log field bank? Okay. Yes, I know.
So the reason why you limit yourself only to that part is because you think you have to go back or do you have some special reason to believe that
I know.
May not be suitable for that design.
In fact, when I begin this work, I just want to show that SME can also be applied to design the acoustical feature, make the acoustic feature better. So I just picked this one out and use SME to optimize this transformation matrix. Of course, I'm sure if we can optimize, for example, the lift or the log field bank.
So it's not limited only to this thing, but everything else.
Yes, I think, in fact, for example, usually in the original, a lot of for example, the transformation matrix or something else are optimized with MLE. Then later, sometimes maybe we can optimize some with some original discriminative training methods. And also we can optimize this kind of thing with the large margin based method. I think
with respect to all the parameters in the front end, optimizing
those all the model parameters, all the parameters, okay.
All the way back to the last book again.
One solution is just to use the LDA matrix to replace the DCT. However, LDA uses the training data, but it doesn't utilize the decision feedback as a discriminative training method in ASR. We know that the decision feedback is very powerful to design good classifier. Therefore, SMFE, it's called the soft margin feature extraction, jointly optimize this transformation matrix and HM parameters together. Here, I skip the detail, just show you that the frame-based log likelihood ratio can be expressed as a function of HM parameters and the transformation matrix. Then we embed this one into the separation measure and the final target function and optimize this final target function to get HM parameters and the transformation matrix together. We tested this work again in TIDIGITS. Here we can see the LDA derived feature performs better than the MFCC derived feature in both the MLE case and the SME case. This SME on the 9M model is just the model I have reported in last section. For 16 mixture, we can get 99.3% string accuracy. For LDA derived feature, SME can get about 99.4% string accuracy. Finally, for SMFE, it jointly optimizes the HM parameters and the acoustic features together. It can get about 99.6% string accuracy in the 16 mixture case. Even one mixture case, we can get more than 99.1% string accuracy. This demonstrates the power of SME. The TIDIGITS task is a clean task. Both the training and the testing is using the clean signals. The question is, the margin-based method original is designed to deal with some generalization issue. This mismatch between the training and the testing set in the TIDIGITS is not severe. Therefore, we look at the robust ASR task. We want to see whether this kind of generalization issue can be addressed well with SME. For robust ASR, for the mismatch between the training and the testing set, we have three mainstream methods to deal with this kind of mismatch. One is in the single domain. Use some signal processing method to reduce the noise in the testing signal. The second one is in the feature domain, use some normalization technology to normalize the test feature. The last one is in the model domain, use some adaptation technology to adapt the training model to the testing set. However, SME will provide us a unique way to deal with this kind of mismatch between the training and the testing set. Because of the margin, it allows the testing sample can be distorted from the training sample with a margin. We tested SME on the Aurora 2 task, just use the simple backend because we want to address the mismatch condition. Therefore, we use the clean condition training and use the standard testing set with test set A, B, and C. The baseline model is 60% accuracy. With SME, we can get 29% relative WER reduction.
I thought the whole point of this SVM theory is to address the issue when training set and test set have the same distribution, but the sample is limited.
Yes, yes.
So now you are dealing with different distributions. So
yes.
Why do you want to use to do the idea that you should do all the optimization and then afterwards you try your best to have the match in terms of distribution and then you do whatever?
Yeah, because we have a concern that if we just deal with the matched condition, this kind of method maybe just fit this kind of matched condition cannot be applied in different kind of tasks. We want to see, because as I have figured in previous sections, we can see in the training set, we can push the samples away from the decision boundary. And this kind of samples, this kind of margin can make us, in fact, deal with some mismatched condition. We just want to see whether SME can be successful in this kind of task. Of course, originally, the margin-based method just want to deal with the matched condition. But in fact, as I have said that, the SME can, in fact, provide us a unique way to deal with this kind of robustness issue. Of course.
So, you train the model.
Yes. Yes.
And you get some improvement. You test with what you
do. Yes. Okay. In fact, I'm not sure I look at it in detail, but in theory, this improvement should get from the high SNR. Why? Because this is our claim trend model, and the margin allows us to get some distortion from the clean training condition. For example, if in the 20 dB case, the distortion from the 20 dB testing and the clean training is not very much. The margin can cover you very well. However, in the 0 dB case, the margin cannot cover you. Therefore, we believe the most gain should be got from this high SNR case. In fact, I didn't look in detail. I don't remember clearly it's the case.
So that's the opposite of what most people find when they get improvement on Aurora. Because
yeah.
The 0 dB has 60% word error rate. If you can improve that at all,
okay.
It dominates your average word error rate reduction.
Okay. In fact, I'm sure in the 0 dB case, in this work, we do not get a lot of improvement. I'm sure that
point. I was making one. If you have mismatched condition, then sub-margin method is not really appropriate. You have to deal with that mismatch first before you can use sub-margin to further improve the understanding problem.
I'm sure because of this margin, we can deal with some condition that is close to your original training. If the distortion is not very large, the margin can cover it. However, if the distortion is very large, we cannot cover it. To address the issue, we also do the following experiments. We add some noise in the clean training set. The method is just add some noise randomly from the four types of noise in the testing set A, that's near the same case of multi-conditional training. However, for the new training set, we just faked it with some fixed level of SNR. For example, a training set with just 5 dB SNR or a training set with 10 dB SNR. Why we do this kind of thing? Because we want to SME can easily cover some distortion. For example, if we use 10 dB case to train the model, then the distortion of 0 dB or 20 dB from the 10 dB case is not as large as the clean condition distorted from the 0 dB case. So let's look at the performance. We can see for SME, for the 10 dB case and the 5 dB case, we can reach about 84.5% accuracy. This means that even there's still a lot of mismatch in the training set and the testing set, we can get some great performance improvement, especially for the 5 dB case, we can get about 32% relative.
So the purpose of adding noise is to create a condition where the match condition kind of gets satisfied. And once you have that, then you expect the matching method to do better than otherwise. This one doesn't seem to support that kind of speculation.
In fact, if we want to add the noise, we just want it make SME easily work with the margin. The margin can cover, the range margin can cover will be easy because the distortion between your 20 dB or 0 dB to 10 dB case, the distortion is not very large. However, if we just use the original clean training set, this kind of distortion is very large. We just want to make the SME can work well. And in fact, in every case, there is still some mismatch between the training set and the testing set because we just use special level SNR for the training.
So in other words, if you don't add the noise, all these numbers will go the other way, right? 29 and then at the top will be...
This is the clean training.
Okay.
And
so do you have the same from the table without adding noise?
This one is without adding noise, right?
Oh, yeah, okay. No, but that's, I'm talking about 0 dB.
0 dB? No. We have a clean training set. We just add some noise into this clean set. Make the new training set with 20 dB SNR or 15 dB SNR or 0 dB SNR.
Oh,
so 0 dB is the noisiest
here? Yes. Oh, sorry. Sorry. Yes, all the SNR. Standard testing.
5 dB SNR to all your test data.
I add 5.
You could create a better mismatch. I mean, a better match between your training and test.
Uh-huh.
Training
yeah.
on 5 dB
uh-huh.
noise. And then regardless of what test signal you get, uh-huh. add 5 dB noise to that.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to do.
You mean add 5... Make the testing.
If it comes in at clean,
mm-hmm.
clean test data,
mm-hmm.
add 5 dB noise to it. If it comes in at 10 dB noise, mm-hmm. add 5 dB noise to it.
Oh, no. I haven't tried.
I'm confident you can get really good results.
No. The whole point I was making is that I mean, it would be nice to see whether what I just said makes sense.
Yeah.
So margin method improves performance typically when the mismatch condition
is not
severe.
Exactly. Yes.
So do you have evidence to show that? Because here, this kind of makes sense, right? Because
yeah.
when you add the noise there,
mm-hmm.
then it kind of creates the condition where the mismatch may not be as bad as the one you talked about earlier before. And then under that condition, of course, you would expect the margin method to work more effectively than otherwise.
In fact, because here, in fact, there are two cases. The first one is just the clean training. And we can see there is big mismatch. And if we add some noise in the training set, we can get a
better match.
Better match, not the...
Relatively speaking, the soft margin method should work better.
Yes, yes.
Whole noisy because there's another training set
and multi-condition training.
Multi-condition training.
Okay.
What happens when you try that?
In fact, I'm not sure because for the multi-condition training, when you get a model, this model is not for 5 dB case or 10 dB case. It's a trade-off model. So I'm not sure what will happen.
And you didn't try it.
Because it's a starting point.
It's the number one simplest thing to try. Because you change one line in your training script. And then
yeah.
you get a number.
And also, I think the result will be quite meaningful because when they get the multi-chain condition, they, on average, the mismatch degree will be less compared to this experiment you have. And that condition, if on the relative terms, matching method can do better than that one, I think that by itself will be very useful.
Yeah, because the starting point of this task is to show whether the margin for SME can deal with some mismatch. So we just focus on the mismatch part. No. In fact, we didn't compare this one with MMI. And there is a toolkit in HTK for MMI, but that one is for LVCSR task, because that toolkit uses the crossword triform model to for the decoding lattice, to decode the whole lattice and use some method. I think for MMI, I'm not sure what Yasa has done.
MMI helps.
Helps, okay.
And I reject your claim that the multi-style is some kind of compromise model.
Okay.
Because if you look at even your clean training data, it's a compromise model because you have different accents, you have different genders in there. The signal is not constant and very well defined. And by adding in the different background noise, it's the absolute best thing you can do in every condition that I've seen is add in training data that's like your test data and see how the training algorithm performs.
Okay, I see.
And MMI handles multi-condition data very well.
Okay, I see. And finally, the SME for LVCSR task. As I have mentioned, SME is flexible with different kind of utterance selection and frame selection. Here, we define two kinds of SME method. One is just the SME with the hinge loss function. The other one is the SME with a cutting threshold. With this one, we deal with the outliers. And that now the separation measure is different from all what we have reported. In the beginning, we just use one string as the competing string. Here, we use all the strings in the decoding lattice as the competing strings because for LVCSR task, we need more information to make our model more discriminative. A little different because here, this is something like the MCE because we need to remove the strings that have the same labels as the target string. This one, in the decoding lattice, we remove the correct strings. And this one, if we use this one and embed it into a sigmoid function, that will be the MCE. GI is the decoding graph of the current utterance.
Have you actually noticed that it makes a difference if you remove the correct
casting
or something?
I didn't. In fact, I think that's the major difference between the, if we do not consider the sigmoid function, that's the major difference between the MCE and MMI. And in fact, I think in InterSpeech 2005, there is a paper from Hemnice group. They reported if they use similar implementation, all these kind of methods will reach nearly the same result. And I'm sure for this LVCSR task, especially for MMI or MCE, they are in the utterance level, and the difference is really small. But for MPE, that's different because they're in the phoneme level. Pardon, do you mean the InterSpeech 2005? Schutter's paper. And what's the point? Sorry. And also, we can define some frame-based SME. We can use similar loss functions here. We compare the frame posterior probability with margin, and sometimes we use the cutting threshold. And this separation measure is now in the frame level. We tested SME on the 5K was the general task. The training set has 7,000 utterances. The testing set has 330 utterances. The acoustic model is cross-word triform model, and the language model is the standard trigram model in the database. This is the WER for MLE. The baseline WER is 5%. And for MCE, it gets about 9% relative WER reduction. For SME, in the utterance level, both methods, one is with hinge loss function, the other one is modified with a cutting threshold. Both. MLE, all the methods are initiated from MLE.
If you want to initiate from MCE, do you get a better result then?
I'm not sure because you have, in fact, you have a lot of local minimums. I'm not sure whether you do have better, yeah. And for frame level, frame-based SME, these two methods have different kind of performance. This one is slightly worse than the SME with utterance selection, but this one with cutting threshold, we can get about 19% relative WER reduction. Why? Similar loss functions in the utterance level get nearly the same results, but in the frame level, we get a different kind of results.
So what's the, at the end, at the frame level, frame selection,
this, you mean this one?
Yeah.
With a cutting threshold to deal with the outliers.
Outlier, I think. Okay. Can you tell me which of these improvements are statistically significant?
Okay, because we have 330 utterances, and the total number of words, I believe, is about 5,000. This one, because we just have so few words, this one is significant than this one. I'm not sure whether this one is significant than this one. I'm not very sure, but of course this one is significant than MLE.
1.3?
Yeah. Do you mean the 20KK data or just the 5K? Oh, really?
The one we run here, I think 6 or 7 years ago we run that Wall Street Journal. I think this MSR is about 5%. You know, you have to run that?
I think it was, well, that's, you built that. 4.6, isn't it?
We do not have 20K database in Georgia Tech. Sorry, we cannot do this one. The reason is that when we look at the separation measure for the utterance-based, SME pushes the samples right away with great separation measure. However, when we look at this kind of histogram, it's a normal histogram. Maybe there are some outliers, so the cutting threshold for the utterance is not very effective. However, this is what we got from the frame level. With frame posterior probability, we can see there are two major peaks around the value of 1 and the value of 0. we believe because in the frame level there are a lot of noisy. We do not know exactly the word or phoneme boundary. We believe there is some outlier here. So if we use some cutting threshold, this can help us and get us better performance. As a conclusion, original SME is proposed just use the hinge loss function. However, this kind of hinge loss function is from the machine learning, but it doesn't work very well. We believe it doesn't work very well in some special cases in speech recognition. We need to handle, sometimes we need to handle the outliers. I forgot to mention that we use EBW to optimize the parameters in this study. And this is the testing WER for different kinds of methods. And all the methods can reach its best performance in about 15 iterations.
The numbers you presented in the table,
uh-huh.
Were they generated by running iterations of training,
yeah,
and choosing the best performance on the test set?
The best.
Okay.
So I still don't know, but how do you the parameters used in the SME? You have rho, which is a marginal, and you have lambda, which is a...
Okay.
You have a cut of
Yes, yes, yes. In fact, in the original, for example, in the task of TIDIGITS or Aurora 2, we randomly select different kind of lambda and jointly optimize the low and HM parameters together. But in this VCSR task, this is our preliminary result. I will talk about this later. We just do not use the lambda. We just fix some cutting threshold or margin value. Yes. Finally, the conclusion and the future work. In this study, I have shown you that SME is a unified framework for discriminative separation, utterance selection, and frame selection. SME can achieve better generalization with the use of margin. SME can get good results in different kinds of tasks. 99.6 in the TIDIGITS task, 32% relative WER reduction on Aurora 2 task, and 19% relative WER reduction on the 5K watch general task. In the future, we may need to investigate how to combine SME with some successful robust ASM methods together. In this study, we just apply SME directly on the training set and get a model out. Maybe we need to investigate how to combine them in a unified framework. And we need to invest SME for even large LVCSR tasks. However, we cannot do this one in the Georgia Tech side because of limited resources. And we want to investigate SME with word and phone level selection. Why? Because in the SME with utterance selection, we discuss the whole utterance. There may be a danger that in the utterance, you have some local discriminative information. It discards the whole utterance. It will be very wasteful. However, for frame selection, as I have shown you in the figure, there are a lot of noisy. We need a cut using some cutting threshold. There is a trade-off between the utterance and frame selection. That's the word and phone level selection. It may be a good choice to use the word and phone selection because they are very stable and they have some local discriminative power.
To do that, is any technique that you would do subject to the sensitivity of the boundary of the phone?
I think that's not a hard problem.
Not
And yeah. Thank you for the attention. Do you have any more questions?
So I thought it's interesting to see the interaction of between the enhancement or this adaptation or whatever normalization, that kind of technique dealing with the mismatch issue.
Yes.
And the soft margin is ideally you know, suited for
the matched
non mismatch.
Yeah.
So what's your thought on this?
I think, yes, because
issues involved, or is it more empirical, or in this case, the iteration, etc.?
I think it's in the heuristic part, because, yes, from the theory, of course, you just want to deal with the matched condition. However, this condition is sometimes is of few interest. Because sometimes we need to deal with the real application. We want to see this kind of margin-based method, whether they can do some, can work with some mismatch. Of course, I know there is no report from this margin-based method that they work on the robust ASR task. But I think it's very interesting to look at this kind of issue.
But I thought machine learning coming last year, the lips, they are beginning to talk about the issue.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I thought this year,
mm-hmm.
Some of the people over there told me that there are a lot of good papers
okay.
dealing with that kind of mismatch condition.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Kind of trying to generalize from the earlier, you know, SVM style. Kind of
I
areas.
See.
So I think
that's
really
interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think related to something Lee asked earlier. I mean, you had said one of the criticisms of one of the other techniques was that I think it was large margination, that they don't have the labeling correct.
Yes. Yes, a good question. In fact, because this SME is original designed, for example, with the hinge loss function, it doesn't take care of some outliers. But for the spontaneous speech recognition, there are a lot of outliers. And for large-scale VCSR task, they use lightly supervised training. This kind of training scripts are not correct. Not exactly correct. Therefore, we may use different kind of loss functions. For example, use some sigmoid loss function to take care of this kind of outliers. And I think SME is open to this kind of issue. We do not fix our loss function with a hinge loss function. In fact, if we want to take care of the spontaneous issue, we need to use some loss function with the, for example, the cutting threshold or just like the sigmoid loss function. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much for your